Keyum Yuyam Anumana Kushalaha.
Who is the person who is doing this inference? What's the nature of this? What is the nature of the one who does the inference? What's the nature of the inferer?
Sharirendriyamasadanaha Atmanahavayam Anumana Kushalaha.
The answer was given. Since the body, sense organs, mind, or the self, none of them can be singly the one that can perform any action. Because the body, sense organs, mind are inert, therefore they cannot perform the action. And Atma is nirvikara, changeless, so that also cannot perform the action. In as much as none of them singly can perform the action, therefore we say that in combination all of these perform the action.
Aneka karaka sadhyatvat kriyanam iti chet.
Because any kriya or action can be accomplished only when so many karakas or accessories are involved, and so an action can be accomplished only when there is an involvement or contribution on the part of all these different factors.
Evam tarhi anumana kaushale bhavadam anekatva prasangaha.
If that's what you say, if you say that none of them can singly perform the action, but that all of them jointly are required to perform the action, then what it amounts to saying is that there are many atmas and many bodies and many sense organs.
Aneka karaka sadhyai kriyayate bhivagatam.
Because you are saying that any kriya or action can be accomplished by many karaka. Karaka means various factors or accessories that are required to perform the action, like the doer, like the object of doing, like the instrument of doing, and so forth.
Tatra anumanam cha kriya.
Anumanam, our inference is taken as a kriya, but any kriya for that matter.
Sa sharira indriya manatma sadhanaihi karakaihi atma kartruka nirvartyate.
And so atma performs a kriya such as inference with the help of all these other accessories. Then the point that was taken up is, when can body or the sense organs and mind or any one of the factors, when can it become an accessory? When it is independently able to perform some, do something. When each one of them contributes, then jointly all of them actually result into an action. As you said, any particular action, like what is going on, the hands are involved, the speech is involved, the head is involved, the body is involved, microphone is involved, so many things are involved. So each one of them actually performs its own actions. Hand performs actions, that's why it is called hand, grasping. And microphone performs its own variety of actions, and therefore, then alone it can become an accessory, you know, in order to accomplish an activity. And so the question is, if hand itself performs an action, then it also requires help of other factors. Then each one of them requires factors to perform their own separate actions. That means there are so many of these factors are required for each one of them. And that way basically an action cannot be even accomplished. That is anavastha dosha primarily, because each one requires the help of many others, and each one of them requires help of many others, and that way you can never accomplish the action.
Tatra vayam anumana kushalaha iti amvadadhi sarirendriya manas sadhanaha atmanaha pratyekam vayam aneke iti abhivagatam syat.
And so it amounts to saying that each one of atmas are many, sarirad are many, indriyad are many.
Aho anumana kaushalam darshitam aprucha sangaihi tarkika balevardaihi.
So what a skill in anumana have you shown? So what you thought was a skill in anumana or inference turns out to be actually ridiculous, because it results into some ridiculous consequences.
Yuhi atmanayona janati sakatham murah tadgatam bhedam abhedam vajaniyat.
One does not know the self. How will he know whether the self is different from others or not? For one to say that the atma is different from other atmas, how can one say unless one knows the atma?
Yattva atma atma pratyogika bhedavan vastutvat ghatavadidi.
The argument was, last argument of page 522 was, the like ghata is different from pata and different from matha. Because ghata is a vastu, pata is a vastu, matha also is a vastu.
Atma pratyogika bhedavan, ghata can be called a vastu.
Only when ghata enjoys ghatatvam, otherwise it cannot be called vastu. A human being can become a human being if he enjoys humanness. Anything can be what it is only when it enjoys that-ness, which differentiates it from otherness. And so book is called book only when it enjoys bookness. Microphone is microphone when it enjoys microphoneness. And therefore, that bookness distinguishes a book from other substances, and that's how each one is separate from the other. In order for one to be separate from another one, it must be possessed of its distinct characteristics. And therefore, you cannot use any word unless you confine that object with characteristics. The moment you use a word like book, automatically the idea of bookness is conveyed. And the moment you use the word table, the idea of tableness is conveyed. The moment you use the word atma, the idea of atmanness, the selfhood is contained. And that selfhood is definitely different from the non-self. Atma is that which is different from anatma or non-self. And therefore we say that atma is different from anatma. So, if this is what they say, tatra atma, that is true also. The general notion that there is about the self, yes. The general notion of the self is an individual entity that is different from other things. That's how I call it myself, as different from non-self. Except that the notion is not right. And so, that is what is being questioned here. Tatra atma pratipannaha apratipannova. Are you saying that the Atma is different from Anatma having known the Atma, or are you saying it having not known the Atma? If you do not know the Atma, then how can you say that Atma is different from Anatma? Yohi Atmanam eva na janati sakatham mudha tadgatam bhedam abhedam va janiyat. When you do not know the Atma or the Self, how do you know that Atma possesses some distinguishing characteristics because of which it is different from Anatma? How can you say that? And so, footnote number 6 was, Pratipannatva Vakshevi Bhedena Abhedena Vatat Pratipattihi. And if you say that you know Atma, Self, then of course there is no question of inference. So, footnote number 6 said, Bhedena Abhedena Vatat Pratipanne Atmani Nanumana Pravuttihi Divhavaha. Once Atma is known, either is different from others or is non-different, then also Anumana is not a scope. Adye anumane siddha sadhanata. They want to prove that Atma is different from others, or the Atmas are many. This is what they want to prove by inference. Now, if you already known Atma is different from others, then there is no scope anumanam, because that's what you already want to prove. That is called siddha sadhanata. What you already want to prove is already assumed. You are assuming that Atma is different from others, then you want to prove that Atma is different. That is called siddha sadhanata, that it cannot be. Antevadaha, if you know Atma is non-different, then of course it is just contrary to what you want to prove. So thing is, number one, do you know the Atma and then are you saying that Atma is different from others? So I do not know. If you do not know the Atma, then how do you know that Atma is different? If you know the Atma, then do you know it as separate from other Atmas or as one with other Atmas? If you say that you know Atma is separate from other Atma, then there is no question of proving, because you are already accepting that Atma is separate from other Atma, then where is the question of inference? You are trying to prove Atma by inference. And if you know Atma is non-separate from others, then what you want to prove itself is contradicted. looks like the game of words, but it is not quite. This just shows how we take things for granted and really do not probe into our conclusions, and so our very standard accepted conclusions are subjected to scrutiny. This is exactly what the Vedanta does not take anything for granted. We take things for granted and then prove variety of things, but then that I am unhappy, then I prove I justify doing all kinds of things in order to become free from unhappiness or sadness. So Vedanta will ask you the question, are you unhappy? So very fundamental axioms or assumptions of life are questioned here. And how come Vedantins are able to question that? Because of the Shruti, Tattvamasi. Shruti says, you are Brahma. Sarvam khalu idam Brahma. Everything is Brahma. And therefore, based on that, we are questioning everything. So we know it. How do you know? Because Shruti is our eyes. So Shruti is the eyes through which we see. And so, as I said the other day, you need somebody to show things. Sometimes we have taken things for granted or concluded, and therefore what is evident also may not be seen by us. Like in a picture having all kinds of lines. Somebody says, see, do you see a deer in that? No, it takes some time for me to adjust my vision, and then I can see how in that whole maze of lines there is a deer. I can see the features slowly and slowly. And similarly, Shruti is saying, everything is Brahman. So, Yoyam Purusha Sahasthanahu, whatever you are taking as Purusha or thief, hey, look closely, it is actually a stump of tree and not a thief. I taken for granted that this is a thief or a ghost. That's all. And I merely go along with that conclusion of fear or whatever I have. And all my vyavahara with that thing is guided by what? That it is it's a thief or it's a ghost. So you find a person behaving very peculiarly even with a stump of tree. Why? Because he thinks that it's a ghost. So when people behave like that, you know, you see some people, they see something there, you know, and he thinks that somebody's sitting there, and then some, you know, here he's communicating with that, and we think it's a ridiculous thing. So similarly also, one sees a ghost, where we know that there is only a stump of tree, and then you find him behaving peculiarly with ghosts. Why don't you go there? What's the problem? Why are you scared? What's happening to you? You do not understand. Ashochan anvashojastvam. Hey Arjuna, why are you grieving? But having taken that conclusion for granted, as I said, all the vyavahara is then actually determined by that conclusion. And similarly, all of our vyavahara in life is determined by various conclusions of life. One of the most fundamental conclusions is that I am different from everything else. Because I call myself Atma. Moment you use any word, Atma, that's it. A word is going to have a meaning that is confined, that's going to confine the object that is indicated by the word. Because that's what a word does. A word means a speech is always limited in name, in form, in space and time. And therefore, even when I use the word Atma, self, it automatically means something that is confined here and that is something that is not there, is just accepted by me. Having accepted that, then you are saying that I am different from others. Or having seen yourself, are you saying that? You just accepted that you are different from others. I have that sense that is accepted. And then all the vyavahara is proved. Then you are trying to prove that. So, na anumana pravrtihi. If you have not known the Atma, this na anumana pravrti. Meaning your conclusion is not right. And if you have known the Atma, then also anumana inference has no scope. And therefore, to arrive at the self, showing all this thereby, that perception or inference are not the proper means of determining the nature of Atma, nature of self, that's all. Self does not lend itself to being inferred or presumed or compared or anything, because it just does not have the linga, does not have the chinha, or does not have any distinguishing mark by which it can be determined. By the means of knowledge that are available at our disposal. Then now, on the page 522, Anandagiri continues the second paragraph. Itasya atma-bheda anumana anutthana mityaha. Itasya, for this further reason, footnote 13, Anumatuh ayogena anuman anutthana muktva to linga vidurvachana vidamanvanaha anumatuh ayogena. See, first question was, who is anumata? Who is the inferer? And it became a mess when he said that the body, sense organs, mind of the self cannot be individual inferred. Therefore, in combination, Atma, in association with those other accessories, performs the action. So when we explore that idea, it just became a mess, you know. And so, anumatuhu ayogena. Anu ayogena. Therefore, you cannot even prove the anumat or inferer. You cannot arrive at it. Anuman anuthanuktva. When inferer is not there, how can there be inference? So first, Vashyakara showed how ridiculous it is to imagine that you are doing inference, having imagined that there is an inferer. You are performing the action, assuming that there is an actor. Who is the actor? Let us first determine that. You could not determine that. All right, you cannot determine who the inferer is. You are taken for granted Atma is inferer. Well, Atma cannot be proven to be inferer. So who is the inferer? You cannot arrive at. So Anumana Anuthana Muktva. So that is the reason why Anumanam is not possible. Now, Tallinga Vidurvacham. All right, accepting, taking for granted that there is an inferer, that Anumanam is possible. Okay. Then also, Anumana, inference, always requires linga, requires something to enable us to arrive at a conclusion. As you said, smoke is a linga or a distinguishing mark for fire, and so because wherever smoke is, the fire must be there, and therefore from the presence of smoke we infer the presence of fire. So smoke is called linga. Something like your mouse is going there, you know. You see the tail, then you know that there is a mouse, because tail is the linga of the mouse. Where the tail is, that fellow must be. And like that. So, this is how inference always requires some kind of an evidence. So, linga means distinguishing mark. A mark that distinguishes it from others. That is called linga here. The linga vidurvachamidamanvanaha. Sankhyeshta janmadinam pratinemadalingam dushayitum avatarayati. Then Sankhyas, they in fact present so many lingas or so many distinguishing phenomena in order to prove that Atmas are many. Sankhyas say that Atma, as we know, they have this concept that the reality is twofold, Purusha and Prakriti. Purusha is consciousness or conscious being, and Prakriti is matter. And Purusha is different from Prakriti. Not only that, but Purusha is different from other Purusha. One Atma is different from other Atma. Atma is accepted by them as consciousness. Chidvapuhu, of the nature of consciousness. Nirvikara, changeless. This is what they accept. And still they say that Atmas are many. So now we are questioning them. They're all right. You say that Atma is consciousness, and Atma is changeless, free from modification, and still you say that Atma is many. What's the reason why you are saying it? Janmadinam pratiniyamadilingam dushayitum avatarayati. Pratiniyam, vyavastha. The Sankhyas accept the multiplicity of the Atma or the manyness of the Atma because they want to explain the vyavastha. The order that we find in our creation, the order that we find in our day-to-day life, that requires that Atmas must be many. This is what the Sankhya said. Our vyavahara, or our interaction and our transactions cannot take place the way they are taking place now, if Atma were one. So, this is how the Sankhyas arrive at the manyness of Atma. So, itascha atma bhedanumana anuthana mityaha kenaiti. So, for this reason also, that atma bheda anumana anuthanam, that inference trying to establish the manyness of atma has no scope for this further reason, kenaiti. So, let us read that bhashya. Tatra kimanu vinote. Kena va lingena nahi atmanah svatah bheda pratipadakam kinchil lingam asti yena lingena atma bhedam sadhayet. Tatra kim anuminodi, that we already seen. If Atma is known or not known, that we have done. Now, kena va lingena anuminodi. Alright, what is a linga, as you said? What? So, lingyate anenete lingam. Linam artham gamayate lingam. So, that which enables us to see the object or something that is hidden from us or that is not evident to us. Like the fire is hidden from my sight, and the smoke enables me to know the presence of fire, therefore smoke is called linga. So kenava lingena anuminoti. What's the linga or what's the distinguishing mark or characteristic of the Atma by which this person infers the manyness of the Atma?
Kim shabdasya. So akshepartatum sputayati.
Kenava lingena. Idea is that. So kim anuminoti? Kenava lingena anuminoti. By with what? With what chinha? Meaning that there is no chinha that Atma possesses by which you can infer something about Atma.
In kim shabbas sabdasya akshepartatum sphutayati.
That there is no chinha about, pertaining to Atma, sphutayati, that is clarified.
Nahi atmanah svatah bheda pradivadagam kinchil lingamasti. Svatah upadhim antarena, footnote number 8, antarena upadhim, svatah.
That Atma appears to be many, all right. But that manyness that appears in the Atma is due to upadhi, due to what we call the limiting factors. Limiting adjunct, as they say, upadhi. And so the duality of the Atma is due to upadhi, not svataha and not due to Atma itself. There's nothing inherent in the Atma that will establish Atma to be different from other things, but only because of upadhi. Like a crystal appears to be different from other crystal, or crystal appears differently at different times only because of the kind of flower or the object that is placed beside the crystal, and how that object imposes its color upon the crystal and makes it appear colorful. So it is because of upadhi alone that the crystal appears colorful and having different colors at different times. Otherwise, there is nothing in the crystal inherently which will actually make it colorful.
Nahi atmanah svatah bheda pratipadakam kinchil lingamasti.
Bheda pratipadakam. So that which will enable us to determine the bheda or the duality in the Atma, such linga or the distinguishing mark is not there in the Atma.
Yena lingena atma bhedam sadayet.
Because which linga or the evidence that you can actually infer or arrive at the duality of the Atma or manyness of the Atma.
Then Anandagiri says, Janmadhyanam pratinemadilingavashat atmahedasetsati chet.
Then Sankhya says, who says the linga is not there? There are many things, in fact, which go in favor of this conclusion that Atma must be many.
Janmadhyanam pratinemadilingavashat.
Pratinema means vyavastha. Janmadhyanam vyavasthavashat. That janma, etc., mrityu, etc., takes place differently in different people, and all of these phenomena actually go to prove that Atma must be many.
Atma heda setsyadi.
And so, the duality of the Atma will be established.
If this is what you say, have to say, and now you see an asterisk there.
So, footnote number 13 is actually included in the asterisk anyway. And so, there is what we call Krodapatra at the bottom.
Janmadhyanam pratinemadi lingavasat.
That prati and nema should be one word.
Janmadhyanam pratinemadi lingavasat atmabhedaheti.
So pratinema means vyavastha.
Janmadhyanam vyavastha lingavasat.
Vyavasthadi lingavasat atmabhedaheti.
Taduktam sankhya charyaihi.
So Sankhyacharya says this, the one who has written the Karikas.
Janma marana karananam pratinyamat ayugat ayugapat pravrtescha purusha bahutvam siddham traigunyam pariyat chayvedi.
So actually Sankhya Shastra is basically composed by, originated by Gautama, and there are supposedly sutras, Gautama sutras also, which are not available, but you find now books having, the sutra of the Gautama, Sankhya. And on those sutras is written Karika by this Acharya. His name is some Krishna, I forget the name. So he has written this Karikas, which are very famous, more famous than sutras actually. So this forms the very basis of the Sankhya Shastra. This is one verse. There are only 72 verses. That's all it is. There are only 72 verses, but, you know, every verse is very brief, but it actually gives a lot of, you know, expresses many ideas, so it's like a capsule. So here, this is the 18th karika, which says, janma marana karana karanana, they want to establish the atma bheda. This is a karika that establishes the bheda or the duality of manyness of the atma. Janma marana karananam pratinivad. Janma, birth, marana, death, karana, sense organs and mind. Pratinivad, because of the vyavastha of the janma, as will be explained, marana and vyavastha of the actions performed by the sense organs. By this vyavastha or by this, the order that we find, that we say that atmas are many. Ayugapat pravrtescha, second one. Ayugapat pravrtescha, that pravrti or activity of the different atmas is not simultaneous. Traigunya vipariyaccha, and also traigunya, the sattva, rajastamas, these three gunas are also different in different atmas, therefore, Purusha Bhavatvam Siddham Evaidi, and therefore, Purusha Bhavatvam, Purusha means Atma, the manyness of the Atma is definitely established. In this tika now, whose tika it is? Vachaspati Mishra. So one who wrote this Bhavati, the tika on Brahma Sutra, as we said, he was one of the greatest acharyas that we have produced, and he has written scholarly commentaries on every darshana. Sankhya and Nyaya and Aivyadarshana, he has written the commentary. Then that time he identifies with that. And therefore Vedantin becomes a Purvapaksha. So you find, so what is reproduced here verbatim is a commentary of Vachaspati Mishra. And here Vedantin becomes a Purvapakshi and he becomes a Siddhanti. So say there, Purusha Bhavatvam Siddham. He says, Purusha Bhutvam Siddham. The manyness of Purusha of the Atma is Siddham. Siddham. Siddham Evaidi. This is already established. Kasmat. Kasmat Karanat. How do you say that the Atmas are many? First thing, Janma Marana Karananam Pratinyamat. First reason. Three reasons are given. Janma Marana Karananam Pratinyamat. Number one, Ayugapat Pravrtesya. Number two, Traigunya Viparyacha Idi. Number three. So first, Vachaspati Mishra explains, Janma Marana Karananam Pratinyamat. Nikaya Vishishtabhi Apurvabhi Dehendriya Manohankara Buddhi Vedanabhi Purushasya Abhisambandhau Janma Kadu Purushasya Parinamaha Tasya Aparinamitvat Teshamevacha Dehadinam Utpattana Upattanam Tat Parityagaha Mananam Nudu Atmanaha Vinashaha Tasya Kutasthanityatvat Karanani Buddhyadini Trayodasha Tesham Janma Marana Karananam Pratinyamo Vyavastha Sakhalu Ayam Sarva Shareeshu Ekasmin Purusha Na Upapadyade Tadakhalu Ekasmin Jayamane Sarve Jayaran Mriyamane Cha Mriyaran. His language is very clear, you know, wherever you go. He is such lucid language, you know, of Sanskrit, he writes, Andhadau cha ekasmin sarveva andhadeva vichitte cha ekasmin sarve vicheva vichittaha syuhu iti avyavastha. So this avyavastha would be there, the vyavastha would not be there. So what is the vyavastha? Ekasmin jayamane sarve jayaran. If Atma was one, then ekasmin jayamane, then when one is born, everybody should be born. If Atma is one, then when one is born, everybody should be born. Mriyamane cha mriyaran. So janma, marana and karana, pratiniyamat. Marana is what? Ekasmin mriyamane sarve mriyaran. And then if one dies, if Atma is one, then if one Atma dies, all of them should die. This is janma, marana vyavastha. So we find that everybody is born at separate times and places and so forth. The death also takes place separately. So that shows that Atma cannot be one, because otherwise, if Atma were one, the birth and death must all take place simultaneously. Then Janma Marana Karana. Karana means the sense organs. Andhadau Chekasmin Sarve Eva Andhadeha. If one fellow is blind, everybody should be blind, and whatever. So whatever happens to a sense organ must happen everywhere if the Atma were one. Vichitte Chekasmin Sarve Vichittaha Sihu. Vichittam Vikshipta Chitta. If one fellow has his mind is distracted, everybody's mind should also be distracted. If one fellow is restless, everybody should be restless. Idi Avyavastha. Pratikshetram Purushabhedetu Bhavati. This kind of Avyavastha. Pratikshetram Purushabhedetu Bhavati. Pratikshetram, if every kshetra, means with reference to every body, if you accept that the Atma is different, then all this avyavastha, meaning this total chaos, will take place. Meaning avyavastha cannot be explained. What we find cannot be explained if the Atma were one in all the bodies. Pratikshetram purushabhedetu bhavati vyavastha. On the other hand, when you accept that the Atma is one, separate in all the bodies, then the vyavastha, or this, the experience that we have, can be explained only when you accept that Atma is different in every body. Go down to the Tika. From the sixth line from the bottom, that is where the explanation of this starts. So this explanation is explained again further. Atma, Atmanah, Janivikara, Prayukta, Parinamitva, Abhavaya, Udyotakaracharyoktam, Janvapadarthamaha. So what is the meaning of the word janma? Janma padatham. Padatham means meaning of the word. So what's the meaning of the word janma, or the birth? So when Vachaspati Mishra explains this janma marana, he uses the explanation of the word janma as given by another acharya, Nayayika, you know. So Nayayika has given this explanation for janma, birth. Atmanah janivikara prayukta parinamitva abhavaya. The Atma actually is free from the parinama or modification brought about by birth and death. That actually Atma does not undergo the process of birth and death, Nayayika also explained. So Nayayika also accept that the Atma travels from one body to the other. Everybody explains, accepts that, all Indians accept that there was previous birth and there is going to be rebirth, and that one Atma alone travels from one body to the other. So what is birth? So therefore the Nayayikas explain what is the meaning of the word birth. So Udyotakaracharyoktam Janmapadarthamaha. Janmapadartha, the meaning of the word janma is given by that Udyotakaracharya, is accepted by Vachaspati Mishra, and that's the word, that's the explanation that he uses to explain the word janma in the Sankhya Karika. Nikaya Vishishtabhi. So in the first line, that explanation was given. Nikaya Vishishtabhi, Apurvabhi, Dehendriya Manohankara Buddhi Vedanabhi, Purushasya Abhisambandho Janma. Nikaya Vishishtabhi. What is Nikaya? Nikaya is Sanghataha. An aggregate, an assembly. Deva manushya tiryagadinam anauttaradharyena avasthitaha sanghataha. So deva manushya tiryag, the gods, the human beings, animals, all of these which are actually obtained as superior and inferior. So all of these are obtaining as superior and inferior. Not, they're all different from each other anyway. An assembly is of various components that are all different from one another, and which enjoy the superiority and inferiority and importance and so forth. Tad vishishtabhi ityarthaha idi tatparitikaya mishra. Mishraha actually. So Vachaspati Mishraha. So Vachaspati Mishraha, they tatparitika again, you know, there. When they explain in the Nyaya Shastra, this is how he explains, you know, the word Nikaya. So, this word Nikaya, anyway, again, this footnote people add their own comments here. Then the word Nikaya is not properly used here. Nikaya Vishishta Abhi, the word Nikaya, is an aggregate of what? Deha, Indriya, Manaha, Ahankara, Buddhi, Vedana Abhi. Deha, the body, Indriya, sense organs, Manaha, mind, Ahankara, ego, Buddhi, the intellect, Vedanas, all the various sensations. So, an aggregate of all of this is whatever Upadhi is. Whatever Upadhi is body, sense organs, mind, intellect, Ahankara, and the various sensations. This is what our Upadhi is. And so, what is Janma? So, Apurvabhi Abhisambandha Purushasya. Apurva means new. So, when Purusha the Atma gets associated with an aggregate, a new Upadhi, that is called Janma. So, association of Atma with a new Upadhi, consisting of the body, sense organs, mind, intellect, ego, sensations, etc. So, association of Atma with a new Upadhi is called Janma. And disassociation of old Upadhi is called death. This is all. So, Nikaya Vishishtabhi, Apurvabhi. Apurvabhi means new. With new, Dehendriya Manohankara Buddhi Vedanabhi. Purushasya Abhisambandha Janma. This is how the Nayayikas explain the word Janma, which is right. You know, for what they consider to be Atma. So here in the footnote, there is some exception taken to the use of the word Nikaya. Evam cha Sanghe, I am reading the Tika. Evam cha Sanghe cha Anottara Dharyayati Sutrena. Nikaya pada nishpatihi darshitam. How do you arrive at the word Nikaya from that Panini Sutra? Yadyapi mahabhashyadi vyakhyanat praninam samuhayevatra sutre sanghapadena grihyade sanghecha. So, in sangha, you can use the word, they arrive at this word Nikaya. So, mahabhashyadi vyakhyanat. When Mahabhashyakar, that is Patanjali, who gives the Vyakhya of Panini Sutras, so when he explains that sutra, Sanghecha, so what is the meaning of the word Sangha that he explains? Sanghapadena Praninam Samuhaeva Atre Sutre Sanghapadena Grihyate. Patanjali there explains that the word Sangha should mean a Samuha, an aggregate of Prani, of living beings, not just anything, of assembly can be of a motor car also, where so many components are there, that is also an assembly. Or this body also is an assembly of number of parts, or this is also an assembly. So what Sangha or an assembly? So Patanjali says that the word Sangha or an assembly should mean an aggregate or a collection of living beings, and not just of anything, you know. Na samuha matram, it is not just any samuha or any assembly or aggregate that can be called Nikaya. But only an assembly of the living beings can be called Sangha. This is how Patanjali Mahabhashyakar explains that. He is called Mahabhashyakar. As again, Shankaracharya is called Bhashyakara. So he is called Mahabhashyakara. But he is the first Bhashyakara. He started, in fact, the whole idea of Bhashya by explaining the sutra. So sutra Bhashya. That sutrakara is Panini. And Bhashyakara is Patanjali. As far as the Nayayikas are concerned, their sutrakara and bhashyakara are different. For us, who is sutrakara? Badarayana. And bhashyakara is Shankaracharya. For them, sutrakara is Panini and bhashyakara is Patanjali. So to distinguish bhashyakara, that is Patanjali, from bhashyakara, that is Shankaracharya, you add one vishesha under that, mahabhashyakara. That's what Vedantins will say, mahabhashyakara. They will call him bhashyakara, you know, the vyakaranas. But anyway, everybody respects Patanjali very greatly. What he has done is most valuable. Because otherwise Pranini Sutras would have been almost difficult for us to understand. And on this Pranini Sutra also, Katyayana, another great Vayakarana, he wrote this Karikas, and he criticized 1500 sutras. He found defects in 1500 sutras of the 4000 odd sutras written by Pranini. Because that's what a Karikakara does, you know. Or a Vartikara. A Vartikara is the one Uktam Anuktam Duruktam. So he wrote Vartika on this Panini Sutra. And he is supposedly smarter than Payani, that's what they say, you know. Payani was from North India, he was from South India, you know. And so both of them were students in the same class. These are all the... Anyway, so Payani received this knowledge from Lord Shiva when he was performing penance. At that time, Sanaka, Sanandana, they also happened to perform the penance. And Lord Shiva appeared before them. But in response to Panini's penance also, Lord Shiva, then he performed a dance, and then he had this damaru from which he created sounds, and from that Panini got all these sutras. You know, the first Maheshwara Sutra, Ayun, Ruluk, etc. Now, beautiful stories, anyway. And so, but then Panini wrote the sutras, and then this Katyayana wrote the Vartika. And he found all kinds of faults, and Panini was very upset. He performed the penance again. And then Sheshanaga appeared before him and said, "Don't worry, I will take incarnation and clear out everything." So Sheshanaga himself took the incarnation as Patanjali and then wrote this Mahavashya on Panini Sutra and showed, taking those Vartikas, that how every sutra is right and how all the faults that Katyayana found are all wrong, you know. So this is what Mahavashyakara is. He is called Mahavashyakara. So, those who have studied the Mahavashya, one used to say, his language is just very beautiful language. So that is a greatness where there is simplicity and beauty, you know. So language is so lucid, so beautiful. So Swami used to say, perhaps Shankaracharya must have studied that Bhashya number of times, you know, to see what that, even of course before Shankaracharya, other Bhashyas are also written. In fact, Shabar Swami had written Bhashya on the Jaimini Sutras also. And in fact, Brahma Sutra Bhashya follows the trend of the Bhashya that is written by Shabara Swami on Jaimini Sutra. Jaimini Sutra is the Purva Mimamsa. On that Bhashya, very beautiful Bhashya is written. And Shankaracharya must have followed that style. I don't know what style he followed. But anyway, so he's called Mahavashya, Mahavashya Divyakhyanat. So therefore, these words are taken as Pramanam. Not only Sutras become Pramanam, but Sutras are Pramanam for us because of Bhashya alone, because otherwise we don't understand Sutra. Even Upanishad mantras are all sutras. And when we say Upanishad is pramanam for us, it is only through Bhashya that Upanishad becomes pramanam. And so everybody calls his guru Jagat Guru. And therefore, whether it is Ramanujacharya or Madhvacharya, all of them, they are all Jagat Gurus for their followers. We say Jagat Guru is Shankaracharya, but then all of them are Jagat Guru as far as they are concerned. There are many Jagat Gurus that way. Which is fine, you know. It's a matter of their Shraddha and devotion, which is alright. But they understand Upanishad through their teachers, and we understand Upanishad through our teacher anyway. And so, here also we understand Panini Sutra through Patanjali. Lot of research work continued, of course, and then other texts are also written, but basically that still stands as the authority. In short, the word Sangha should be used only for an assembly of living beings and not just for any assembly. Ataheva Brahmana Nikaya Itivat. And therefore, you should say Brahmana, you can say Brahmana Nikaya, an assembly of Brahmins, you can say. Na Pramana Nikaya Iti. You cannot say assembly of Pramanas, you know. You cannot say, because they are inert things. Apidu Pramana Nichaya Iti. And so, when you want to use the word assembly, I mean, want to indicate assembly of non-living things also, then pramana nichayaha. This is how. And so the word nikaya should not have been there, nichaya should have been there. This is the idea. Tathavi, prani sambandhitvena kathanchidatravi, prani samuham sambhavya, nikaya pada prayoga upatihi naya. But still Vachaspati Mishra and all these acharyas have used the word nikaya and udyotkara. And therefore, we must accept that the use of the word Nikaya must be right. There must have some reason, been some reason. So, when we have this kind of Shraddha, it enables us to arrive at some reason as to why they must have used it. Tathabhi prani sambandhitvena kathanchidapi kathanchit atrabhi prani samuham sambhavya. Since all this body, sense organs, mind, all of these are actually associated only with pranis. So, prani sambandhitvena. So, in themselves, the body, sense organs are not living beings. And therefore, this Dehendriya Mano Hankar Buddhi Vedana Abhi Nikaya Vishishta Abhi, you cannot, should not use the word Nikaya for them, because they are not all living beings. But inasmuch as the body, sense organs, all of them are connected to living beings, सो तथापि प्राणि संबंधित्वेन कथंचित अत्रापि प्राणि समूहं संभाव्य. सो हियर ऑल्सो एज दो इट इज अ समूह और असेंबली ऑफ द प्राणीज द लिविंग बीइंग्स निकाय पद प्रयोग उपत्ति ही नया दैट द यूज ऑफ द वर्ड निकाय दैट शुड बी अंडरस्टूड दैट वे. Association with a new aggregate consisting of the body, sense organs, mind, ego, intellect and the sensations. So, association with a new assemblage would be called Janma. So, now the Tika says, Nanu, the last line. Nanu devadatto jata hiri vyavahara darshanat mukhyameva ghatadehevi atma eva atmaha janma. न जायमान देहादि संबंध रूपम भक्तमिति तत्राह. क्वेश्चन ननु देवदत्तो जात इति व्यवहार दर्शनात् बट वी फाइंड वी से देवदत्ता इज बॉर्न यज्ञ दत्ता इज बॉर्न सच एंड सच फेलो इज बॉर्न दिस व्यवहार सो व्यवहार में शब्द प्रयोग है सो हाउ डू वी यूज दिस अवर एक्सप्रेशंस आर व्हाट देवदत्ता इज बॉर्न यज्ञ दत्ता इज बॉर्न विष्णु शर्मा इज बॉर्न और सो ऑन सो फोर्थ. It is vyavahara darshana, so this is the kind of vyavahara of the shabda prayoga, the use of expressions we have. Therefore, mukhyameva janma, we say that atma is born in the prime, really born. Ghata deheva, just as a pot is born, really born. Similarly, atma is really born because we are saying that this person is born. Na jayamana dehadi sambandharupam bhaktam or gaunam. So you are saying that word janma, see, nayayikas. By saying that Janma of the Atma is merely association with a new assemblage, thereby saying there is no Janma really. So by saying it is like this, that this fellow is transferred from one town to the other, now he has left this house and entered another house. So it's like that. So this house is given up, that's called death, another house he enters, that's called birth. But that is not the Janma or the birth in a primary sense, because he's not born. The same fellow goes from here to there. Therefore, the Nayayikas explained that the word Janma or the birth is not primarily for the Atma. We just use the word figuratively, we use the expression Janma or the birth for Atma, but it should be understood as not in the primary sense, it should be understood only in a secondary sense. Bhaktam. Bhaktam is Gaunam. So the point is that why do you say that Atma is, the birth of the Atma is merely association with new body, etc.? Why not we say that Atma is really born? Just as, because the word birth is always used that way. When we say Devadat, when we say Ghata hai Jata hai, so a pot is born, we see that the pot which was non-existent comes into existence. Similarly, Atma that was non-existent came into existence. Why not we accept the birth in a primary sense that way? So there, Vachaspati Mishra said, Natu Purushasya Parinama iti. So, natu purushasya parinamaha. Ishwara Krishna, that name I remember by the way, Sankhya Karikaka is what? Ishwara Krishna, that is the person who has written the Sankhya Karikaka. Anyway, so, natu purushasya parinamaha iti. So, Vachaspati Mishra said, the Tikaka, that's it, Vyakhyakara. So, natu purushasya parinamaha. So, he said that you should not imagine that the Janma, the birth of the Atma is actually a change or modification taking place in Atma. Birth of the Atma is merely association with a new upadhi. So that Tika says, Ghata Deheva. So Mukhya Utpatti Rupaha Parinamaha Purushasya Nachaityartha. That is where Atma is concerned, that there is no, because for birth to take place, a real transformation must happen. For the cur to be born from the milk must be a real transformation for the cur to take place, for the cur to be born. And for also the pot to be born, a real transformation should take place. If you accept birth of the Atma in that sense, then we will be required to accept a real transformation in Atma, which it cannot have. So, ghata dehe mukhya utpatti rupaha parinamaha purushasya nacha. But then, purusha or Atma doesn't have this parinama. Why? Aparinamitvat na atmanah mukhyam janma iti avata. But Atma is aparinami. So Sankhya also accept Atma as aparinami, changeless, free from transformation or modification. No mukhyam janma, and therefore the janma or the birth in case of Atma is not primary. He says, Sankhya himself says, just go one step further and you will find that Atma is one, you know. So in fact, their own discussion will show how Atma is actually one. But anyway, they also say that Atma, the birth of the Atma, cannot be in the primary sense. It has to be only in the secondary sense, in the sense of association with Nivupadhi. And then continuing the Tika on that page 524, Maranantu yadyabi nung pranatyagai dismanat. So mru dhatu is there. In the sense of pranatyagai. So pranatyaga means what? Giving up the prana, giving up the life, is called maranam. That is smarana, that is the, again, the dhatu patha. Panini has written the dhatu patha, giving the meaning of this dhatus. What all work they have done, you know. This is all very easy for us, but what an amount of work, what an amount of research they must have been required to write Vyakarana Sutras and dhatu patha, to arrive at the meaning of a dhatu or a root, you know, or a verbal root. What an, all the usage, possible usages must have been actually been seen, and that's how. Like today we are writing this dictionary, like Apte's dictionary. What an amount of work must have been done. He must have researched all the use, all the literature, all the Puranas, every conceivable literature in Sanskrit while preparing that dictionary, that kosha. Because you find in this Apte's kosha that one word has sometimes 40 meanings, you know. And you give a reference as to where that word is used in that particular meaning. So what an amount of scholarship is there. Anyway, with all the means available to us, how Panini must have done it at that time. But anyway, so mru pranatyage. Ismanat pranopalakshita dehadinam tyagrupam mukhyameva atmani sambhavati. So pranopalakshita dehadinam. So prana there means deha etc. Prana also includes deha, sense organs and all this upadhi. So mukhyameva atmani sambhavati. As far as death is concerned, death is giving up the pranas and giving up the soul upadhi. So atma does give up everything. In that sense, you can say that the death can be in a primary sense in atma by that meaning. Tathavi ghatadeheva vinasharupam varnavatrama kaschid grahi. So, as the word mru or the death is understood in terms of the pranatyaga, in sense of giving up the prana, and prana includes the body and everything else, so giving up the upadhi, that kind of death does take place in atma. However, generally what we understand by death is destruction. Generally when we use the word death, we mean destruction. So when you say the pot is dead, means what? Pot is destroyed. Then one should not understand death in the sense, in the case of Atma, in that sense, that Atma gets destroyed. So, tathāpi ghatādeheva vināśarūpam varnavatrama kaschid grahi. That somebody should not actually think that death of Atma means destruction of the Atma. Iti āśayanāha natu vināśahiti. So, vāchas there, Mishra said, so, teshām eva ca dehādīnām upāttānām parityāgham maranam. That very upadhi which he had accepted at the time of birth, giving up that very upadhi is called maranam. Nutu atmanah vinashaha. But don't imagine that atma actually dies or gets destroyed. Tasya kutastha nityatva. Because atma is kutastha nitya, meaning not only parinami nitya, but kutastha nitya. Nayayika will accept him as parinami nitya. But then Sankhya will accept him as kutastha nitya, means changelessly eternal. Never undergoes any change, and therefore there is no destruction of the Atma, so death should not be understood as destruction. Then, going back to the Tika on page 524, na jayate mriyate va vipaschit ajo nitya shashvatoyam panah ityari shrutya atmana janmadi parinama shunyatvena kutastha nityatva nityatva amnanat. Na atmanah mukhyau janmanidhanam ityasah. Na jayate mriyateva vipassit kathopanishad says, vipassit or the conscious being is not subject to birth or death. Ajo nitya shashvatoyam puranah. That same Shruti says, atma is unborn, undying, free from growth, free from decay. Ityadi shrutya atmanah janmadi parinama shunyatvena.
So Atma is very clearly stated there as devoid of any parinama, any modification, beginning from birth, so any modification, he is changeless. Kutastha nityatva amnanat. That's how Atma is declared by the Vedas as kutastha nitya, or ever changeless. Now Atmanah mukhyau janmanidhanau, and therefore, janmanidhana means death. So janmanidhanau, the birth and death, cannot be applicable to Atma in a primary sense, because Shruti very clearly says that Atma is free from any kind of change or modification.
Manam bhut jato mrtahiti vivaharat naranam vyamohati anukampavati bhudaranyaka Shruti api. Manam bhut jato mrtahiti vivaharat.
So this tika also is written very well, you know.
So jatah mrutahedi vyavaharat naranam vyamoha mabhut.
Since the nara, the human being, that is vyamoha, this tremendous delusion. Because we use the words, see, the words create concepts, that's all. That's the reason why the words are very powerful, both ways. And therefore, when you say a clay pot, and a golden pot, and a silver pot, so you think that the clay is a modification, is a visheshan of the pot, and silver is a adjective of the pot, and so on and so forth, which is wrong. It is pottery clay and so forth and so on, and therefore, it is pot that is a visheshan of the clay and not the other way around. But we say clay pot. So moment we use that word, automatically the idea, because what is the first word is visheshanam, second is visheshya, automatically the relationship get established in our mind. And so also when we use this word jataha, mrutaha, he is born, he is dead, so, iti vyavaharat, because this shabda prayoga,
naranam vyamoha mabhut,
that the human beings do not have this vyamoha or this tremendous delusion that really birth and death take place, that kind of delusion should may not be there.
Iti anukampavati brahadaranyaka shruti.
This brahadaranyaka upanishad, because of the total anukampa or compassion towards the human beings, whom they feel, so who? Shruti feels that will be totally deluded because they use his words, born and dead.
Savayam purushah jayamanah shairam avisampadyamanah sah utkantam utkrantam utkraman mriyamanah itevam swayameva shariradina sayujjamanatvam eva atmah jayamanatvam sharirat utkramanameva cha atmah mriyamanatvam nirah.
So what does Brihadaranyaka Shruti say about the birth and death?
Sava ayam purushah jayamanah shariram abhisampadyamanah.
Not only Nayayika say, even the Brihadaranyaka say, Sava ayam purushah, this self.
Jayamanah,
when he is born,
shariram abhisampadyamanah,
he is only acquiring a new body. That is called the birth.
Sah utkraman mriyamanah.
And same person or the Atma is called dying when he actually departs from this body.
It evam swameva.
So in our own words, very clearly Shruti says,
Shariradinam sayujjimanatvam eva atmah jayamanatvam.
The birth of the Atma is nothing but the association of the Atma with a new set of body, etc.
Sharirad utkramanameva cha atmah mriyamanatvam.
That departing from the previous set of body, etc., is called the death. This is what the Brihadaranyaka Shruti says clearly in our own words, so that the jantus should not have, the people should not have the confusion or delusion with reference to what is birth and death.
Evam cha devadatto jatah ityadi vyavaharah bhaktah ityatra phalidam.
The idea is that even when we say devadatta is born and yajnadatta is dead, that vyavahara, that shabda prayoga, the expressions must be understood only in a secondary sense and not in a primary sense.
Etachya charachara vipashrayastu syat tad vipadeshah bhaktah tad bhava bhavitvad ityadi brahma sutra bhashya vaktavya vyaktam.
Same thing is also said in Brahma Sutra. So Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, first of all, Katho Upanishad and other Upanishads very clearly say that Atma is kutastha nitya. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad actually gives the meaning of the word janma and mrityu. And Brahma Sutra also says,
charachara vyapashrayastu syat tad vyapadeshaha.
That vyapadesha. Vyapadesha means the designation or the use of the words janma, mrityu, etc. can be there primarily in sense of chara, achara, with reference to upadhi. Because, so upadhi, as far as the names and forms are concerned, you can say the birth and death take place in them, like a pot, etc., in a primary sense. Or even for the body also, there is birth and death.
But, bhaktah tad bhava bhavitvat.
But with reference to Atma, the expression of the words born and dying, dead, is only bhakta, is only secondary. Because the Atma is associated with the body, etc. Therefore, the birth of the body that takes place is taken to be birth of the Atma, and death of the body is taken to be death of the Atma, and therefore, the birth and death taking place in the body of the Upadhi are attributed to the Atma, and therefore, for Atma they are in the secondary sense, and for the body they are in the primary sense. And so the expressions birth and death, they are applicable in a primary sense to the body and the assemblage, and only in a secondary sense to the Atma. And why even in a secondary sense to the Atma? Because Atma does get associated with a set of bodies, etc. Therefore, those expressions must be used as understood in a secondary sense with reference to Atma.
Ityadi Brahma Sutra Bhashya Vyaktam. This is what is clarified in the Brahma Sutra Bhashya also. Okay, so this is going back to the previous page, the third line. So, first of all, so karika is janma marana karananam. Thus the Tikakara first explains what is the meaning of the word janma. What's the meaning of the word marana? What's the meaning of karana? What's an instrument or the means? What's the means? Karanani buddhyadini trayodasha. So they accept karana or the means as 13, 5 organs of perception, 5 organs of action, and then manaha, buddhi, ahankara. This is how they come to arrive at 13. Now, explaining that karika, janma marana karananam pratinyamat, so the Tikakara says there, so janma marana karana, Tesham Janma Marana Karananam. Of Janma Marana and Karana, that is Janma Marana Karananam, Pratinyama Vyavastha. So that Vyavastha. Sakalu Iyam Sarva Shareshu Ekasmin Purushe Na Upapadyade. Sa Iyam Vyavastha. This Vyavastha. Na Upapadyade would not be tenable if Sarva Shareshu Ekasmin Purushe Sade. If one Atma alone was there in all the bodies, then this Vyavastha that we find, that the birth and death and all the activities, the level of the sense organs, all of these are different in different people, that could not have been if Atma were one. And so if Atma was one in all these bodies, this Vyavastha or this Vyavahara that we find would not be explicable. Tadakhalu. Tada means what? If Purusha was one, if Atma was one, then what would have happened? Ekasmin jayamane sarve jayaran. If Atma was one, then when one is born, everybody would be born. Mriyamane cha mriyaran. And when one dies, everybody would die. That is janma vyavastha, marana vyavastha, then karana vyavastha. Andhadau cha ekasmin sarveva andhadeva. Andhadeha. If one person gets blind, everybody should get blind. Vichitte cha ekasmin sarve vichittaha syuhu. And if one person gets upset or disturbed, everybody should get disturbed. So that is what the Tika says there. Tadakhalu. Says idamcha arthapatti pradashanam atmaikyavadinam vedantinam prati. This is being said to whom? Tadakhalu. If Atma was one, this is being told to whom? To Vedantin. This is called arthapatti. This would not have been anyatha anupatti. This could not have been, had it been so. That means the birth and death and all the activities are taking place differently in every body. That could not have been so if Atma were one. And therefore, all this variety, the differences obtaining at the level of body may enable us to presume that Atma is also must be many. So this is also pramanam called arthapatti. Idam cha arthapatti pradarshanam atmaikyavadinam vedantinam prati. This Vedantin is being told that how can Atma be one? Otherwise all this ridiculous situation would arise. Swamate tu janmadivyastha vastu bheda nibandhana iti dhyayam.
Somade Sankhyamate. As far as the Sankhya is concerned, he has no problem. This is the problem that Vedanta will have. Sankhya has no problem at all. So that's what he said. Pratikshetram purushabhedetu bhavati vyavastha. However, if you accept the Atma as different from all the bodies, then this vyavahara is very neat. Then everything is neatly explained. Otherwise, it is not neatly explained if you accept Atma as many. Then go back again to Tika. Nanu yatha akashasya ekat. When Vedantin will tell him, Vedantin has an argument for all of this. How does Vedantin explain the multiplicity obtaining the level of body in spite of oneness of Atma? So, all the acharyas have done that. Nanu yatha akashasya ekatvepi ghatadi upadi bhedena upadhikam bhedamadaya vyavastha asthiyate. And for that is quoted here a verse from Mandukya Karika, Advaita Prakaran. Yathaikasmin ghatakashe rajo dhumadi bhiryute na sarvesam prayujyante tatha jiva sukhadi bhedi. So says Mandukya Karika, yatha ekasmin ghatakashe rajo dhumadi bhiryute. So there are so many parts are there, associated with every part is a ghatakasha. If one ghatakasha gets associated with raja, dhuma, etc. So if one ghatakasha becomes, you know, associated with dust and smoke and so forth, it is not that the rest of the ghatakashas are also associated with dust and smoke. Tatha jiva sukhadi. Similarly also, Vedantins will say that the sukha dukkha, etc., janma mrityu, all of these are actually the dharma or the attributes of the upadhi. And therefore, if one upadhi, one antahakaran becomes happy, then it doesn't mean that other antahakaranam has to become happy. Because the happiness, etc., the attributes of antahakarana and not of the parts are different, the ghatakasa is not different, and so also the antahakaranas are many, but then atmas are not many. This is how aupadhika bheda. So that's why they say, nanu yatha akasha sekatvepi ghatadi upadhi bhedena aupadhikam bhedamadaya. Even though Atma, just as Akasha, the space is one, and still the Vyavahara is called Ghatakasha, Mathakasha, Karakakasha, all these different Vyavahara, Shabda Prayoga is there, even though Akasha is one, and what is that brings about the Shabda Prayoga? The Upadhi. Is Ghata, Pata, Matha, Karaka, etc., so all of the Upadhi brings about the Bheda in the Shabda Prayoga. So, Upadhikam Bhedamada, Vyavasthasthiyate. So, how we explain this oneness of space? And even though we use different words for the space, so space gets qualified by ghatakasha, part space, and cloth space, and the room space, and so forth. So how that vyavastha is explained by the upadhika bheda, bheda obtaining not in the akasha, but the bheda obtaining in the upadhi, namely ghatapata, etc. Tatha atrabi deho upadhikam bhedamasthaya vyavastha asthiyata. And similarly also here, his sankhyas, Vedantin tells him, why don't you also accept that Atma can be one and all the differences can obtain the Upadhi level, and so that can be explained in Vyavastha. If one can explain the Vyavastha, you need not imagine many. Because to imagine more than required factors is called Gauravam. And so we must accept minimum factors to explain Vyavastha. In fact, all the Prakriyas are Sankhyas, Nyayakas are all Prakriyas, really speaking. All of them are trying to explain Vyavastha, the world, our experiences. That's what it is. And other people are also trying to explain. Scientists also have their own prakriya. The physicists have their own prakriya, and then the chemists have their own prakriya, the biologist has his own prakriya, trying to explain this world. That's what they are trying to do. So we tell them that why do you have to imagine that atmas are many in order to explain this vyavahara, when this multiplicity can be explained by accepting the duality, obtaining the level of upadhi. Kim gauragrastena paramasikena bhedena. Why do you accept the real duality in Atma? The upadhika bheda can be accepted. Why do you accept the paramasika bheda, real duality? Because that would bring about gauram, except assuming more things than what is required. Iti ashinkam nirasati. But they have an answer to this. A very interesting answer he gives. That if you say that, so we say that Atma is born because Upadhi is born. So birth takes place in Upadhi, and that is attributed to Atman. Death takes place in Upadhi, that is attributed to Atman. And therefore, happiness takes place in Upadhi, attributed to Atman. And everything happens in Upadhi, either in the body, or the sense organs, or the mind, or intellect, or ahankara, and that is attributed to Atma. And therefore, all the dualities obtaining in the Atma are Upadhika due to Upadhi. Then he has an interesting explanation. Go back again to the previous page. Nacha ekasyabi purushasya deho padhana bheda vyavasthadi yuktam. So he presents the Purvapaksha. Ekasyabi nacha, if you just take aside, you know, leave aside. Ekasyavi purushasya dehopadhana bhedad vyavasthayati. This is what we would say. Ekasyavi purushasya, even though the Atma is one, dehopadhana bhedad, because of the bheda, the manyness, obtaining in the upadhi, then the vyavasthavadi, what you find, the vyavahara can be explained. So, this little thing was explained in detail in the previous tika that we read. Iti nasya vaktam, don't vaktavyam, don't say that. So, Sankhya says, no, you, that is not right. Why? Panistanadi upadhi bhedenapi janma mananadi vyavastha prasanga. Just stretching it to a ridiculous extent. Anyway, but then after all, upadhi means upadhi. So he says, panistanadi upadhi bhedenapi. Pani means a hand. Stana means stana. So breast. Upadhi bhedenapi janma mananadi vyavastha prasanga. By this also you will accept janma manana, etc. How? Nahi paano vrukne. Not vrushne, but vrukne. नहीं पाणु वृक्षणे जाते वास्तनादो महति अवयवे युति ही जाता मृतावा भवति इति. Suppose there is a girl, so पाणु वृक्षणे, if the hand is cut, so this upadhi has died, you know. In that case, if you say that the death of the upadhi is the death of the atma, that's how, then the hand is gone. In that case, you would say that this girl is dead, because the upadhi is gone. And so नहीं पाणु वृक्षणे जाते वा स्तनादो. The girl is small. When she grows, then stana also grow there. So स्तनादो महति अवय युवती ही जाता. Then you don't say that the युवती is born. Otherwise you need to say that, because पाणि स्तना etc. are upadhis, and when they go away, when they come, then you need to say that the birth and death are taking place, but we don't say that. So he says that, look, the birth and death of upadhi cannot be the birth and death of the atma. Otherwise this ridiculous situation also will happen. And so go back now, that's what the Tikakara explains. Nacha ekasyapeti tathasati dehabaddhas tanadinam dehavayavanapi upadhitvena bhedakatvam syat. If you say that the attributes of the upadhi actually determine the expression about the atma, then dehavaddha stanadinam, so the stana, the hand, etc., that are actually associated or connected to the body, upadhi, they are also upadhi. So if the whole body is upadhi, hand also is upadhi, and this is upadhi. So upadhi tvena bhedakatvam syat, then this also will actually become bhedaka, meaning they will also bring out bheda in the vyavahara. So it is that tathacha deha avayavod bhava nirodhabhyam avi purushasya janma mananadi vyavahara syat. So if one avayava is born in the body, then you say the purusha is born. If one avayava goes away from the body, you say the purusha is dead. This is what you have to say. Why? Because so upadhitva is common. Where the body is upadhi, avayava also is upadhi. Therefore, the panistanaditi. So that's why Vachaspati said, so panistanadi upadhi bhedenabhi janumananadi vyavastha prasangad. That's the Lord to say. So we say, prasangasya ishtatvam, that sounds good. That's exactly what we say. Prasangasya ishtatvam asankhya vyavahara virodhaya parihati. He says, no, that is not the vyavahara. You would like to say that, yeah, why not we say that? If the, some the avayava is born, so person is born. Avayava is gone, person is gone, we are willing to say that. He says, no, we don't say that. Vyavahara virodhena, in vyavahara we did not say that. Nahi. So that's why it was said, nahi paanam vrukne jateva stanadau mahati avayave yuvatihi jata mutava bhavati iti.
So going back, bhavati yat anena chatra svagocharo vyavaharah suvishayakam vajnanam upalakshaniyam yam haste patide yutihi mritayati. Adho haste patide yutihi mritayati. If the hand is fallen, you will say that the person is dead. Stanado chajate yutihi jatayati. And then when this avayava is grown, you say that yuti is born. Iti cha na kena api vyavakriyate. Nobody is svagocharo vyavaharah. That kind of vyavahara is never found to be there. So vishayakam vajnanam napi jnayate. Nor is it known that whether a person is born or a person is dying, dead. Iti atraha, atraha, artha, phalitaha. So, yadyapi stanadau jate balyam viha yivatvam praptaha sanghataha. It is true that when the stana is born, then the sanghata, the body definitely has now attained. The balyatvam is gone and yivatvam is born. That is true. The child is gone, the youth is born. Tathapi tadavachedana tadadhishthatriya ha na jatatva vyavaharaha. But we don't say that the youth is born. The sanghata change takes place, but we don't attribute that to the person. Sa eva yam avalayati pratyabhijnana. It's the same, you know, the same girl. It's abhijnanat. This is what he says. And therefore, otherwise, bhavan matetu kaya upahati janmana tadvachedene atmani jatatva vyaharat vat kaya avayava janmana api atmani jatatva vyaharasyat. So, in your theory, the Sankhya says to Vedantin, just as the birth of the body is, it brings about the vyavahara of the birth of the Atma, so also birth of an avayava also should bring about the vyavahara of the birth of the Atma. Upadhitva avisheshad, because both are upadhi, such badhitaha, but we don't find that kind of vyavahara. Itina upadhika bheda kalpanaya nistaraha iti bhavaha, and therefore, by accepting the bheda of the upadhi, you cannot arrive at the bheda in the Atma. Very close. When they argue, they should know the you know. In fact, all these arguments are proving their own, you know, our own point, or they're disproving what they're trying to say, because they themselves say that association of the body is called janma, and disassociation of the body is called death, you know, amrityu. That means what? One body is born, and then you call the birth of the. But he doesn't call the birth of the atma as birth of the body. Association of atma is birth of the body. We say that the birth of the body is called the birth of the Atma. He says, association of the Atma with the body is called birth. Because we don't say Atma associates, because Atma is one, has nowhere to go and nowhere to come. So you cannot say Atma is associated with a new body. Atma is ever there. A body is born, and that's how we say the Atma. So what is the difference between our concept of birth and their concept? If we say that the birth takes place in the body and that is attributed to the Atma, death takes place in the body, that is attributed to the Atma, they say that association of Atma with the body is birth, and disassociation of Atma with the body is death. So they say that if according to you, the birth of the body is the birth of the Atma, and death of the body is the death of the Atma, then any part of the body also is called body, upadhi. And so death of any part of the body should be called death of Atma, and a growth in one part of the body should also be called the growth of the Atma, but we don't say that. Since we don't say that, therefore what you say is wrong, and therefore the Veda, the actually duality in the Atma cannot be aupadhika. So, aupadhika Veda kalpanaya na nistarha, therefore you, the explanation, so vyavastha cannot be explained merely by the upadhi Veda iti bhavaha. Then the Tika continues, Sharirani pratishariram vivhinna purushadishthayani ayogavat pravrttimatvad rathadavadidashayana pravrttam hetvantaram avtari vyachaste. And so, now continuing the other argument. So I think we should continue tomorrow. The other argument is how the ayogavat pravrtti, how the pravrtti is not simultaneous. Pravrtti would be simultaneous if Atma were one. And so, Pravrtti is not simultaneous, therefore Atma is not one. That is the explanation is very similar, not much different, you know, from what we already discussed.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om. shanti shanti shantihi shankaram shankaracharyam keshavam badarayanam sutra bhashya krutau vande bhagavantau punah punah ishvaro guru ratmedi murti bheda vibhagine Vyomavadvyaptadehaya Dakshinamurtaye Namaha Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.
Share position of the nature of the Atma is going on. The Sankhyas say that Atma, the Purushas, are many, for which they give various reasons. One reason is the Vyavastha, the order that we find, or the manner in which we find the Vyavahara taking place. Janma Marana Karana Nam Pratiniyamad, that Janma Marana Karana, all of these take place separately in different beings. So people are born at different times, people die at different times, and with the sense organs, they all perform, people possess different sense organs and possess different nature of sense organs. Meaning somebody sees well, somebody doesn't see well, somebody is blind and so forth. All these variety we find, therefore we say that, and this cannot be explained if Atma were one. Because if Atma were one, then all of them should be born together, all of them should die together. If one is blind, then everybody should be blind. This is what we would expect. However, what we find is something quite different. Therefore, we say that Atma, the Purushas, are many. This is what we discussed. Then, Ayugabat Pravrtescha. This is the second point here that is being discussed. Ayugat Pravrtescha. So, on the page 523, somewhere in the middle, in the Krol Patra, we find Ayugavat Pravrtescha. So says the Tikala, Itascha Pratikshetram Purushabhedaha. So, 7th and 8th lines, Itascha Pratikshetram Purushabhedaha. Itascha, for this further reason also, we say Pratikshetram, with reference every kshetra, every upadhi, Purushabhedaha. For this further reason we have to say that the Purusha of the Atma in different upadhis are different. Ayugavat ityaha ayugavat pravrtescha. Because the pravrti is not yugavat, not simultaneous. So, Tikakara explains that Vachaspati Mishra pravrtescha prayatna lakshana yadyapi antahkaranavartini tathāvi puruṣe upacharyade. Pravṛttiṣca prayatna lakṣa. What is pravṛtti? Prayatna. So effort is what is involved is called pravṛtti. So anything that involves an effort is called pravṛtti. Yadyapi antahkarana vartini. Where does the effort obtain? So pravṛtti means activity and effort. Where does it obtain in the primary sense? Yadyapi antahkarana vartini. Even though primarily the pravritti or activity is only in the mind, they say. Again, why? Because Atma is nirvikara. So since Atma is kutastha nirvikara, changeless, therefore Atma cannot really perform any pravritti or activity. That's what they accept. And therefore the activities that take place, actually take place in the mind, tathāvi puruṣe upacaryate. Even then, in Atma, in fact, secondarily, we say that Atma performs activities. Even though activities are performed primarily, even the Sankhyas, this is what the Sankhya says. So, if you go to page 524 in the last line, Sharirani Pratishariram Vivinna Purusha Adhishthayani Ayogapat Pravartimatvad Rasadivatiti Ashayana. Sharirani, this body is Pradishariram Vivinna Purusha Nushtayani. We say that with reference to every body there is a different Purusha or different Atma. Meaning every body is presided over by a different Atma.
Why is it so? Ayogapat pravartimatvad.
Because all the bodies, they act at different times, they do not act simultaneously. So, Atma we do not see, but we infer the presence of Atma and the nature of Atma by what we see. So what we see is a body, pravritti or activities taking place at the level of body. And we say that the activity in the body can take place only when the body is presided over by a conscious principle, namely Atma, otherwise the body cannot act. Just as a dead body does not act, only live body acts because it is presided over by the conscious principle, namely Atma. And now you find these bodies acting differently. One body goes in the north, other one goes in the south, and so on and so forth. And so the pravritti or activity of all the different bodies are different. They are not simultaneous. From there we say that, we infer that the Purusha or the Atma that presides over different bodies must be different.
Rasadivat.
Like rasa, like a chariot. So chariots are also inert entities. And chariots are presided over by the charioteer. So we find chariots all acting not simultaneously, going in different directions and acting independently. And we know why is it so. If only one person was driving all the chariots, then all the chariots would have acted in the same manner. But since different people are driving different chariots, therefore we find the chariots actually functioning in different way. Each chariot functions in a way different from other chariots. This body can be compared to a chariot. In other words, a chariot also is inert. And an inert thing cannot be active unless it is presided over by and unless it is propelled by a conscious being. So you can say that even the chariot is propelled by the horses. They are the conscious beings. And they are also different in different chariots. So rathadivat iti ashayana. So this is an inference. Inference. They are arriving at the nature of Atma from inference. So for vivastha, janma, marana, karana, this vivastha, we infer that Atma must be different. Secondly, that the pravritti or activity of the body is not simultaneous, like the activities of the chariots. How they are not simultaneous? They are all individual, and we know that every chariot is presided over by a different conscious being, and so also every body which acts different from every other body must be presided over by a conscious principle, by an Atma that is separate in every body. Iti āśayana pravruttam hetvantaram. With this intention, another hetu, hetvantaram, ayogapat pravrtitvād. So this fifth case also shows hetu, the reason. Why? Purusha bhedaha siddhaha. So what is it that what is proven is purusha bhedaha siddhaha, that Atmas are many. This is what is established according to them. So pravrtischa. So this pravrtischa is from the vakya pravrtischa. So pravrtischa prayatna lakshana yadyabhi antahkarana vardhani tathavi purushe upacharyate. So even though this pravritti primarily obtains the mind, in a secondary sense it is said that it is the pravritti of the Atma. So that the Tika explains on that page 525. Pravrtischa tatra chalanatmakah pravritti rupo vyaparah sharira dharmah. Chalanatmakah pravritti rupo vyaparah sharira dharmah. This vyapara, the activity which is what we call pravritti. Chalanatmakah, that involves chalanam or movement. So that is what we call pravritti. So that vyapara or activity which involves movement is the dharma or the attribute of the body. It is accepted. Chalanatmakah pravartanarupah prayatnasya chetana dharma. So you see how nicely things are defined. What is pravritti? Pravritti is sharira dharma. It is attribute of the body, of the nature of chalanam, movement. Chalanatmaka, that which is responsible for that movement. So that which actually prompts that movement. Pravartanarupaha, pravartanam, meaning prompting or directing. So that which actually directs that movement. Prayatnascha chetana dharmaha. Two kinds of prayatna is there. One is karanam, so kartrutvam and karayitrutvam, doing and making someone do. So horses are drawing the chariot, but the charioteer makes the horses draw the chariot. Similarly also it is the body that is performing the activity. But it is Atma, the Purusha, the conscious being that actually makes the body act. Otherwise body cannot act on its own. An inert thing is never found to act on its own. An inert thing always acts when it is made to act by a conscious entity, like a chariot. So pravritti rupaha vyaparaha sharira dharma, pravartana rupaha vyaparaha atma dharma, purusha dharma, chetana dharma. So pravartana rupaha chalana atmaka, to make the body move, to make it active, so that is the nature of atma or the consciousness.
Tathacha pravrtehe ayaugapandya darshanena pravartanaru prayatnasya anaikyam.
So we find that prayatna. So prayatna meaning the movement taking place at the level of body is different in different body. Therefore that which actually is responsible for that effort also must be different.